Abadi, 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 welcome. What's up, everybody? Today I'm making some boss switches, so I'm going to draw some cool art for this boss switch. So we've got some really rad art for these boss doors. It's really making the levels more varied and stuff to have these just this room you come in where you see this big old boss door. Now I want to be able to walk into the actual room where you get the switch for the boss door for that to be really cool. So for now, I just got this little computer thingy that you hit once the enemies are dead in the room. And that kind of worked, you know, that kind of works mechanically. So that's cool. Then mechanically, I could go and hit that thing. And then, yeah, the boss doors would open. That's sweet. But it doesn't look very visually appealing. So next step here is to take this and make this just really, really cool looking. Okay, so I'm going to start with just some art, get into Photoshop. I'm going to open up the existing item chest. It's going to be, I'm thinking this is going to be a floating pyramid, a crystal pyramid thing that floats on a pillar with other pillars coming in from the top corners, so it creates sort of a triangle effect with everything. Hello, Zesco. What's up? Yo. How you doing, man? So I'm grabbing the chest. Just chest up PSD, that's similar. Okay, now this pillar right here, I'm just grabbing about the width of this. Thanks, Esco. What's up, Tefen? Yo, I just started the stream like seconds ago. Welcome to it, everybody. 16. So these are 16 pixels. All right, so this image, 32. This one's 32. Alright, so I'm thinking this is going to be about 32 as well. Maybe we'll give it 48. Height 112, something like this, similar. What do you mean, Zesco? What could be better about it? What's up, Creeper? Yo, it was great, man. Yeah. Daniele and I got together. And we had a good chat. It was fun. We got to see some art too, and yeah, it was cool. I hope he can get to check out the Golden Gate Bridge. Apparently, the Golden Gate Bridge the entire week has been foggy. Where did I put that poster to? How do you mean, Zesco? I'm not quite following you here. They look to be just coming out of the side, not the whole coat. You mean like if it was like this more? Yeah, right, Defend? Yeah, totally. It's so windy. I biked it once too, and it's like trying to it's like trying to run in sand. Is this what you meant? They look separate from the coat. What's up, Kiwi? Yeah, I don't think it's that big of an issue. I see what you're saying. I think I see what you're saying now. That these kind of look like they're coming out from in front of the coat, but I don't think many people are going to really notice that. I mean, personally, I have to look really, really hard in order to and focus on that just to see it myself. Yeah, I'm just gonna leave it how it is. I'm already printing these posters, so. And besides, I really don't think it's that big of an issue. Okay, so I'm getting back to what I was doing here. Drawing a new switch. So this is where the enemy, you'll be able to hit this switch and open up the boss door. So it looks really dumb right now. I'm gonna draw it really cool. What's up, professional novice? Okay, so I'm gonna start drawing this. Craig got my art pen. Maybe actually this time I'll go and start with a screenshot. That'll probably really help. Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Okay, so I'm gonna take a screenshot of this room. So I usually make art and then throw it in the game as fast as I can to see if it's working. But I think today this is going to be such a big screen or a big piece of art that I think I want to start with a actual screenshot. Oh, what were you stuck on? All right, okay, I don't actually want to see this screen without that stuff. Without the enemies, without the switch. So here's one here. I can just turn on no foes. That's gonna do turn off the enemies. And then the next thing with foe with the switch, area creation switch. Well, there's one switch. Oh, I guess I hacked in the switch. No wonder it's so crazy. Where the heck did I put that? Area creation, computer zero. Where's the other computer zero? Ah, here it is. Okay. Switch. Alright. So I'm just going to hack. I'm going to turn this off for now so it doesn't even draw a switch. Run it again and get a clean screenshot. Oh, crazy. Huh, that does sound challenging. Right? It's my tiny window. There, okay, now we got a clean screen. All right, this is the canvas we're gonna use to draw this stuff. What's up, clock? Oh, tell me about it, right? That's one of my crazy problems too. Always trying to get some good solution to make good GIFs. Dude, and then Tumblr makes it even worse because Tumblr resizes your GIFs and breaks them almost every single time you upload. And then both Tumblr and Twitch have this, or both Tumblr and Twitter have this maximum 3 megabyte thing. But what I've found is that on Tumblr, you actually have to make your GIFs under 2 megabytes for them to actually work. So it's such a pain, right? Oh, man. What's up, Achillium? Yeah, getting good GIFs is really, really hard. And then if you do actually use a Giphy Cat link or Giphy, the other one is Giphy, or Imgur. There's Giphy with a PH. There's Imgur can do GIFV. And then, of course, Giphy Cat can do the Giphy Cat or the GFY links. If you actually post one of those on your Twitter, it doesn't actually show up in your media. So it's like not really worth posting for me because I want things to actually, if I post an image on Twitter, I want it to actually be a part of my Twitter feed, you know? Oh, okay. Interesting. Virtual dub. Oh, what's that? I know. It's a real pain. And I mean, you think it's 2015. You think that we would have freaking some good technology for GIFs these days. I mean, we do. We have Giphy. We have GIFV. But both of those like don't work with Tumblr really. And they don't really work with Twitter either. So it's like, come on, Twitter. Come on, Tumblr. What's virtual dub? Oh, okay. I see. Nice. I know, right? Yeah. Yep. It's crazy, right? Yeah, so that's also too. Like I don't use those Giphy Cat links and stuff because it's just like nobody's gonna click on your image on Twitter if you just post a link or if it's just an external link. Yeah. You need to gift to get? I got it. I got that joke. I know, right? That's the biggest thing. It's like, why can't we just post an MP4? Gosh. Get it together, Twitter. I live here in the Bay. I should go to Twitter's office and tell them myself. Get it straight, Twitter. I think it's something like this. Do this on a new layer. Bring Nico's backup. Thanks, Zesco. Definitely got to bring Nico's backup. Nico, fly back from Argentina. I need you for backup. So, I've been trying to imagine what the heck this is going to look like in my mind for days now, and it's just not coming to me. So, I'm just going to start drawing and see what the heck happens. It's usually how things go for me. I'm trying to visualize it mentally, and it just doesn't work sometimes. Sweet, man. I know, right? Yeah, both of them do amazing jobs at posting their gifts. And they do, yeah. Amazing gifts. I noticed the Chicken Sword, Miguelito, he does like more clean gifts. I almost think that he posts it straight from his game almost. And then like Megasphere, Anton Cadin, he like does more it looks like he almost films videos and then turns those videos into gifts somehow. But yeah, and somehow their gifts turn out amazing. We gotta should ask them, seriously. Either one of those guys. Gotta tweet and ask them or something. What's up, Horvath? Zesco, I'm making a big switch, man. And I'm kind of riffing on this. I have no idea what I'm creating here yet, so. And besides, the lighting is not being applied neither. So when this actually goes into the game, there'll be lighting. Oh, okay. Interesting to note that. Hello, Punchwood. Welcome to the stream. My day's going great. Art babies. This one's got too much saturation. Let's turn that saturation off. Yeah, so this week does have some saturation to it. I want to use this, but a little brighter for this. All right, so what I'm doing here is I'm laying down some shapes first before I do anything else. Some overall shapes. So I'm thinking this is going to be a sort of a pillar here in the middle with a floating pyramid type thing, and then these huge other sort of connector pillar thingies. In fact, this pillar thing might be a little too wide already. Yeah, I know. Yeah, that's same here. Oh, professional novice. I don't know. I think it's kind of depends on the company. You know what I mean? It's at least in in game development, I know for sure they're a lot more willing to hire from experience. It totally depends on the company though. Like I heard like I wouldn't even know. I never apply for jobs in the game in any kind of development, any software industry. I always kind of work for myself, so I guess I wouldn't really know. But I think it really depends on the company and how cool they are. What's up, Begloff? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I think that's true in a lot of cases. They do kind of look over whether you have a bachelor degree or not, but sometimes they don't. I've been fired for a job one time because I didn't have a bachelor's degree, and they're like, "Whoops, sorry, we shouldn't have hired you." And then some jobs I've got, when even though I didn't even have a bachelor's degree, they're like, "Dude, you have great experience. We're just going to hire you." So I think it really depends. Yeah. Zisco, this is a big switch. It's a switch for opening up the boss door. Yeah, Ekloff, I'm drawing a big old switch. So the boss doors, the big old boss doors that are opening up. I'll show Zesco. I don't think Zesco's seen this one. But let's go to days, and one of these should be the boss doors. Yeah, here. This is what the boss doors look like. They're these big, big, tall. This is an old graphic. Shoot, this one's really old and ugly. Where's the new one? Here we go. Here's what the new ones look like. So this is what the big boss doors look like. And so they need some kind of big switch that you hit. So you defeat all the enemies in a room. It activates the switch, and then once the switch is active, these doors will open up. So that's what I'm creating. I'm creating a big graphic for those. I'm just experimenting here. Yeah, right. Okay, so I'm gonna start blocking in this idea I have for like a horizontal or like a diagonal type thing. In fact, so I'm gonna flip this over. These things are gonna stretch down from the ceiling. Wait a minute, this is kind of nice actually. Never mind. Undo that. Duplicate this layer. Flip it back over. Oops. thinking that's looking more like what I was thinking. Fat pillar here to start, and a pillar that stretches down from the ceiling as well. Oh, that's not centered. Yeah, there we go. All right, so flip this. Yeah, I like that one. This is a good start. I should save this as something, I guess. Sprites, items, switch. This is kind of switch 4, but I'm gonna name it switch 1. Bombus, what's up, man? It totally depends, but usually I'm using a 24-bit palette, so no, I'm not restricting it to a specific color palette, and then I just kind of blend tones based on what looks good, and then sometimes I'll take something I draw in like 24-bit color, and then I'll reduce it back down to 8-bit color, so it only has like, you know, 16 colors or whatever. But I find it more comfortable to draw in 32-bit color. And what you see I'm drawing here, I'm drawing on top of this scene, which is a screenshot from the game. And this scene is rendered in 24-bit color, but the what I'm drawing on top of it is not rendered with the lighting. So this is all going to change once I actually put it in the game. So once it goes in the game, these pillars I'm drawing right here will look a lot different. And so I'm just kind of drawing it on top of this scene just to kind of get a feel for the proportions. What's up, Kalane? Howdy, howdy, howdy. What's up, what's up, what's up?
I wish I could listen to you live stream at the same time.
All right, Tefan. See you, man. Have fun doing the crime. Which part of the lighting? Are you talking about the shadows, or the shadows that come off the bottoms of player and other stuff, or are you talking about the actual just the whole screen where it's got this soft transition right here where it goes from light to dark? Oh, the shadows on the player. So you're talking about right here. That was, yeah, it was really early on in the game. Actually, I think it was the first week of development. Okay, yeah, the shadows are right here. Called it dynamic lighting and shadow. Yeah, here it is, day five. This is where I start, where I did the dynamic lights and shadow for the shadows for the player's feet and all that. So here's that. That's day five. And the other one where I was working on the shader. Forget when that was. It's not psychedelic shader. It's not the shader magic. It was here, day 30, secret shader sauce. It was around here. You're probably gonna have to search through these videos and maybe go back a video or forward a video to kind of find out about it all. But here you go. Day five and day 30. What's up, Ferk? Howdy. I'm drawing a big old switch thing that's, I don't know, I'm not exactly sure how I want this all to look. So just kind of experimenting, playing around. Like that is too bright. I wonder how I got that be that bright. Oh, there's this nice softer highlight here. All right, so I'm gonna take this. Nice. Right on, Ferg. Yeah, I always hope they help, man. I'm glad you learned something, and thanks for telling me too. That's cool. Hi, Adavel. Welcome to the stream. These are a bit dark. Cool. Actually, I can almost see some bolts of lightning going between here instead of this triangle. Yeah. Maybe I'll do that. Some bolts of lightning. Let's see what that. Yeah. Let's draw some lightning and see what that looks like. So I'm gonna grab the same color I used for the glow. It's pretty cool, actually. Think I like this, actually. Okay, so I could draw some cool random lightning like this, and then duplicate this layer and do a blur, like a maybe Gaussian blur 1.5-ish. Yeah. All right, cool. This is it. I want to do switches like this. So basically, when you go into this room, you fight all the enemies, you kill all the enemies, and that will activate this switch. And once this switch is active, then the boss doors open up. Cool, man. I love how I had no intention of doing a lightning bolt like this, and then all of a sudden, once things just start getting drawn, just let your heart go. You stop thinking with your mind. You just draw with your heart, and eventually, just something cool happens. Because I was so thinking about this all week. I'm like, what am I gonna do for the switch? But really, once you actually do it, that's when everything changes. All right, cool. So I'm gonna draw in a few different layers of this. Yeah, let's get a few different layers. So I'll merge these. There's one layer of lightning. Yeah, Jim better stay away from that. He's gonna get shocked. Oh, I just realized that lightning can actually flip X. So like, I can get twice the number of frames out of Lightning by flipping it horizontally in the code or vertically. Wow. Oh my gosh, four quad frames. So I really only need like two or three different of these frames of Lightning. So let's do frame two. All right, frame three. Try and get a real zigzag going on here. Nah, that one's too wiggly. Well, I guess I could do one more layer. It's not like this is hard or anything. Wait, what's up? What's up, Proton? Ooh, I got an idea. I think I'm actually going to make the base of these pillars wider. That'll be fun. All right. Yeah. I know it's a lot to learn. For me, it's an ongoing process. You know, I'm not committing to Vim or anything yet, but every day I am learning a little more. One thing I learned yesterday was that actually Vim keys are not that great for playing games with. So, like, you know, I was thinking, okay, I switched my game keys from playing this game, from playing Songbringer. I switched to up, down to J and K, and the left, right to H and L. And the one thing that kind of sucks about Vim keys is you can't really comfortably go and press down and left at the same time. Your index finger has to switch from the J key to the H key. And that little motion right there, switching between those keys, makes it hard to when you're heading in the downward left, like southwest direction. Hello, Alpha. Thanks for following. So yeah, I'm gonna expand out these pillars, these bottom and top of this pillar. Make this a little more epic. Draw this epic of a scene here. Oh, cool. Yeah, rad idea, Creeper. Totally. Yeah, I like that one by one thing for sure. I'm trying to think of how to do more animations like that where things happen over time slowly, almost more cinematically, you know? So yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah, plus one for Linux, nice. What distro are you on, Alpha? Oh, that's an idea too. Oh, interesting. Yeah. I like that. That's cool. That kind of show progress and it'll show why this pillar thing is activating. Zorin? What's Zorin? I never heard of Zorin. Designed specifically for Windows users. Oh wow, yeah, it does look very Windows. Cool, how do you like it, man? I love this. Thanks to Zorin's OS's immunity to Windows viruses. Isn't that a great thing just to hear? Immunity to Windows viruses? Hell yeah. Nice, really? It's really good. Wow, gaming as well? Cool. Yeah, Adobe, huh? Hello, Nano Game Streams. Welcome to the live stream. Oh, what? Cool, man. Welcome. Cool. Oh, that's good to hear. Wine is actually still making progress. I remember using Wine back in like 2001 when I first started experimenting with Linux, and it just wasn't cutting the mustard back then. Yeah, so that's better. That's adding like a little extra, just a tiny bit of epicness to this pillar thing. Let's do one more layer here. Thanks, Nano Game Streams. Appreciate that. Yeah, so I'm gonna do one more little cake layer. It's almost like a cake. One more cake layer for this thing, and then some more for the top. And I love Creeper's idea of putting some runes on here that light up as you get more enemies defeated in this room. This bit is, what was that? 11. This one's 11. Wow, that was lucky. So, yeah, I guess I'm going to do another whole layer. I love finding art shortcuts like this, like splitting this up right here. So I don't have to redraw. Okay, let's see if that looks too much like a cake. Yeah, I don't know if I like that third layer actually, now that I've drawn it. Maybe if it was half the height. Oh yeah, that's kind of looking better. Oh, that's too much. Yeah, of course. Ask any advice anytime you want. Wow, you're in the sixth grade? Cool. That's good. Wow, you know a lot of languages already. Or a little bit of a lot of languages already for such a young age. That's cool, man. Oh, man, that's a really, really good question. Really good question. Wow. I would love if some other experienced game devs would chime in on this one. But my personal opinion, my instinct is to tell you to stick with what you know and master it. I know, right? No one's given any C++ 14 any love yet. Not yet, but one day, I mean, once Microsoft Visual Studio actually starts supporting C++ 11 fully, then we can start thinking about 14, right? So yeah, nano games, I would honestly say stick with what you know and master it because, what's more important, making an awesome game or coding a game awesomely? You know what I mean? Once you release your game, no one will ever know. No one will ever care how well you coded your game or whether you coded it with C++ or what. You know what I mean? They'll only care if it breaks. You know what I mean? So if you're using Game Maker and your game runs well and you're doing well with it and you're learning lots of things, I'd say stick with it. And the great thing about what you're doing with Game Maker is that you're learning about the whole process of making games rather than focusing too much on one specific area of making games, which is programming. You know what I mean? You can be – the thing about being a game developer is you need to have a well-balanced skill set in programming, art, music, storytelling, all of these things, all of these art forms. You need to have a good – blend of all of those. And I think that sticking with Game Maker, you're going to get more blend of all those skills, and you'll get to being a master, a game development master of all those things faster if you don't focus as much on programming. That's my personal opinion. But I would still keep on learning C++ 11. I wouldn't focus too much on Java or Python myself. But yeah, I would keep on learning C++ if I were you. And maybe doing some like tutorials and keep on learning things on the side, sort of. But I don't know. That's my opinion. And you know, yeah. Maybe if there's anybody else watching right now, they can chime in on that. It's a great question. And also, the stream's not so busy today, so you might want to come back and ask it that again on another day. Maybe there's some other people out around that could help out and answer that another way that might help you. So. Yeah, good for you, man. That's so great that you're learning, that you're making games at such a young age. That's rad. And you seem to have a very good, you seem to be very intelligent. So I respect you. That's awesome, man. Whatever he said. Yeah, I don't like this third layer here. I'm taking this off. Looks too much like a cake. Cool, man. And I'd love to see your game, man. If you have screenshots or whatever, feel free to share them. Share links to your game. I love seeing other people's projects. And I love to root for you guys because you guys have been rooting for me for so long. And not only that, but it's really cool to see your guys' progress and what you're doing, what you're up to. It's just nice to know that we're all kind of part of something. You know what I mean? Like, we make games. All of us make games somehow. And how many other people do you actually know in real life, in your actual day-to-day life, that make games? You know what I mean? Usually not that many. Maybe you're different and you actually have some game development friends. I mean, and I do too. I do have some people in the game development industry and all that, but really I don't interact with them on a day-to-day basis, so it's really, really healthy, I think, at least for me, to interact with you guys and just be sharing stuff. Yeah, it's a community, right? It's cool to be able to share stuff because we can talk about C++ 11, but my girlfriend has no clue about C++ 11, and she never will. She looks at code, and she goes, oh, gibberish, 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 gibberish. She actually says the word gibberish. It's funny. So, okay. All right, back to drawing this cake, or not cake. I'm going to make this no longer a cake. There, sort of just a two double pillar thing right there. In fact, I think I'm going to leave this pillar alone right here and add some runes to it now. Okay, you know what? I'm actually going to write something actually with letters this time. Right? Pretty colors. What's up, Dumbtard? Hey, it's been a minute. How you doing, man? All right, so I'm going to put some actual letters. Like, I usually just write random stuff that I think is in this alien alphabet. So this time, I'm going to grab the actual letters for the word fight. And I'm going to use those for this pillar. Font. There it is, font. Yeah. Themes are important, right? I can't even read code when it's not themed out with colors sometimes. Like, wow. Colors play a big role in making it easy. Oh, this is the wrong font. I want the alien font, not this font. Alien font. Doo-doo. Yeah, right? Well, I guess it's not so sad. I mean, most schools are like that. You know, most of the world is like that. Hello, thanks for following. All right, so which one of these is F? I guess I do need the other font. Both fonts. Engage. There you go. Yeah, right? And that too, right? They're only middle schoolers. Welcome to the stream of Lamidi. Lamitai? Is it Lamitai or Lamidi? Or something else? Okay, here's the F. It's right there underneath the dash. I think it was this one. Yeah. So it's a triangle. The first one's going to be a triangle up here. I'm gonna draw it in this sunken style. So I'm going to turn off this glow and draw it with this sunken darkness here. Lamity. Lamity. All right, cool. I got it. Lamity, Lamity, Lamity. What's up, Ethan? All right, there's F. Now we need I. I is three characters to the right. Oh, I is a lot like a regular I. So let me see if that's correct. I, JK, I, JK. Okay, yeah, that's what an I is supposed to look like in this alien alphabet. So I is two pixels wide. But I guess in this one, we're just going to do one pixel wide. No, I haven't heard of Geometry Dash. There's the G right next to the F. So that's, oh, that's like a backwards. Upside down L. It's a little big. Okay, FIGH. Upside down triangle. Wow. Not giving this language points for originality, but consistency, yeah. Size of my canvas. I do everything at it's almost 256 pixels high. And it's like over 400 pixels wide. So it's like less than 640 by 480. It's widescreen ratio. Ethan, this says fight. T. Where is the T? Oh, it's right beneath the H, which is a slash. Not the most interesting characters, actually. Maybe I should do a different word. I might just do some random runes instead of an actual word, actually. I don't know. What's up, baby? I'm streaming. Reminds me of Burning Man. Yep, Ethan is gonna glow. That's the plan, man. Yes, Lamatea totally does. Yeah. That's what gives me this look here in this game. It's Coco's 2DX base game here, Songbringer. And I use GLSL for all the shaders. That's what gives it all this lighting. So I really just took a screenshot of the game. And then just I'm drawing all this stuff on top of it, but this is what the actual game looks like without all this new art. And this is all done with shaders, and this is all GLSL shaders to make it look like this with all this lighting and stuff like that. Totally GLSL, man. Okay, damn. I gotta turn on what layers were these? There we go. I don't want the bottom layer of the cake. What's that? Oh, I don't need this triangle thing. I don't want that. Let's get rid of this stuff I don't need. Triangle might, I might actually reuse the triangle. There, that's better with these letters a little thicker. All right, so next step is to make these glow when, as each enemy in the room here gets successfully defeated, each one of these letters will light up. Thanks to Creeper for the awesome idea. Four high. Four I, four. That one was one, two. How many people made a video on Songbringer? There's been like three people that have done Let's Play videos so far, but it's entirely restricted to the press. Only the press has had these exclusive builds. But there's an alpha build coming up at the end of the month. The people that backed the Kickstarter at the $128 and above, they get alpha access, and this is finally going to be the first alpha release here at the end of June. All right, duplicate that. Do a Gaussian blur on it. Oh, that's too much. Okay, I'm gonna do less Gaussian blur than that. That's 1.5. Let's try one. Maybe even less than that. 0.75 maybe? No, maybe even 0.5. Yeah, 0.75 was good. No, Ethan, this game is never, ever, ever free. What I just said there was that the people that backed the Kickstarter at the $128 level and above are going to be able to play the alpha version. That was part of the deal. Part of them backing at the $128 level means they get to play the alpha version when it comes out. Nice, Bombas, right on. Cool, good for you. Price equals one kidney. That's right. One kidney. I'll take a limb too. Limbs are good. Limbs are good. Right, so I'm going to separate these runes out into separate layers. And then it's pretty much ready to put into the game. No. Nope. There's never going to be a free demo of this game. My big toe. Dang, a big toe, dude. That's a hefty price just in itself. I mean, dang. Ow. Just thinking about that, right? Damn. Yeah, I think this is the last one here. Rune glow. All right. Yeah. Hey, what's up, Felix? Okay. Now I'm gonna verify that this whole thing. So I'm gonna take. I'm gonna turn off the background. Give it a trim. Want to do a black background to so I can see if there's this if this glow has any issues. Nice. Cool, yeah. Yeah, I'm excited to get the Steam release done for sure. I can't wait till January of next year where I can finally just release this game, you know? But there's a lot of work left, that's for sure. Lots of artwork left, especially now that the game engine itself is kind of getting sort of complete in a way, I guess. I mean, not complete, but like over half complete, at least. All right, this rune looks okay. I'm just making sure that none of the rune colors bled into the other frames. Yeah, it looks okay. Yeah, all right, cool. That works. All right, so now to export all of this, and Sometimes I export things by doing new slices, and then it's really easy to do to export. But this one's kind of different. You can't really make slices out of this. Yeah, the floor already does fall, Ethan. It's like giving birth, right? Yeah. 9 months later. I know, yeah, they could. They definitely could, I think. I think one of the big things is that the controls, people aren't really satisfied with touchscreen controls for especially for old school games like that. Wow, I never knew Nintendo had zero debt. That's amazing. That's a really cool for a company. True, right? All right, here's the first frame. So I'm gonna be manually exporting all these frames. All right, so I'm selecting ping 24 sheets items. Switch one base. Yeah, I'm going to put this a part of its own group. So I can easily turn it on or off. Cool, Bahamas. Nice. I love it. I love the perspective. Oh, I like how that did the transparency. Nice work, Bahamas. This is sweet. Yeah, man. Oh, look at that. Oh, this is like a power bow shot. Dude, I love that tuck and roll too. That's super cool. Yeah, right on, man. That's awesome. Yeah, they could create debt because it costs a lot to market each game. True. Well, yeah, that's true, right? Such a good question, right? If we could actually go and ask not the CEO, but like the executives and things like that at Nintendo, why aren't you doing this? There probably is a reason, right? And I would guess that a lot of the money that Nintendo makes is from their actual hardware. So they really want people to play Nintendo games on Nintendo. It's my guess. And you guys are probably already talking about that up here. Yeah, it's true. It's true. They would totally have a high demand. Yeah. They do have a high demand, in fact, because old school Nintendo games are rad. Have you guys seen Retro VGS? This is what I'm stoked about. Actually, I emailed the guys from Retro VGS, and like, I would love to be part of your first batch of games. Songbringer would be a really good fit for this. Yeah, it's the first like cartridge-based system in a long, long time. And the cartridges last, or they're rated to last 100 years. I guess how long a cartridge can last with SSD storage too. So like we're talking gigabytes worth of data you can put in each game. Yeah, you can use whatever language you want. In fact, you can switch, if you read the FAQ, like the FAQ has some good information on it, like you can switch that console into different modes. So it can actually not quite emulate, but it actually turns the processor or whatever into a different mode so that it can em not emulate, but like run the instruction set for old school games. Like I forget how old console games worked and stuff like that, but you can switch the instruction sets too. What's up, Big Mac Dev? Yeah, no, their plan is definitely not to make it Android based. If you read the FAQ, it goes into all this because Android based would be just another Ouya, you know? We already have an Ouya game console system. And this is something also, this Retro VGS, they're never ever going to allow it to update. So it never ever connects to the internet. So when you buy a cartridge, you actually buy a game. It's like it was 20 years ago when you buy the cartridge. That's the final game. It's never going to update that game. What's up, Andy Brads? I know, right? It's actually the first console I've been excited about buying in a long time. Right, we got all that lightning exported. I know, right? And I miss the days where game developers actually worked really hard to make sure their game was awesome before they put it out. Not like today, where it's just like they don't care because they can just patch it, you know? Oh, Nano Game Stream, I'm working on exporting this drawing. Here's the final drawing. So it's got like this, and then these runes grow. Light up and glow, so like there's that one, that one, that one. And so, you know, now I'm exporting it all and putting it into the game. We're making this all work. So I've got the lightning all exported. Now I need to export the runes. Here's rune one. Man, I love how this drawing turned out a lot different than I was expecting. So that's the beauty of like letting go and just letting art turn into whatever it's supposed to. Yeah. Halo 2. I never played Halo 2. Are you talking about, was it really buggy or was it like did they have to update it like crazy at first or what? Which rune was this? Was this three or four? Switch rune four. Cool. That should be all of them. Yay. We got all everything we need to put this together. Oh yeah. That's awesome. I know it's great when bugs make things fun. All right, cool. I'm putting away my art pen now, and it's time to switch into code mode. Make this all happen. Make it all turn into something cool. So the first thing I'm going to do is to start with, why did it need this old profile component for chat for computer zero? Attributes, didn't use those. Sounds, didn't use those. Just use animations for idle. Oh, because it was animated. Yeah, we're not even gonna use an animation. Okay, so we don't need a profile component for this switch. It's gonna start with the switch one base dot ping. Okay, let's see if this even shows up. The plist file is just something that I developed for my game to make it so easier. Yeah, it's really useful. It makes it really easy to load a bunch of different sprites and turns the sprites into actual animations here. In Cocosuite X, you have to kind of like manually load your animations. So you take all the ping files, you put them into an animation, and then you're good to go. So yeah, it loads all your animations for me. It loads all the like sounds. It loads properties. So it's very useful for sure. And it's pretty easy to do it in your own game if you just like code up something that loads stuff from XML or JSON or whatever. Wow. Yeah, cool. Good for you, Big Mac Dev. What's up, R2? Okay, so we got this switch in here now. That's good. Now, to start making it right, the first thing I want to do is put it down a little lower, so it should be like down about like here, maybe two or three places lower. Switch pause, 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 pause. Thanks for following. So I'm gonna put it down two tiles to start. I think it's maybe a bit too dark. And the first thing I want to do is start getting some lightning to spark between it. Wow, cool. Nice, that's cool. All right, good. The Z ordering's working. All right, I'm gonna put the collision components. It's a little taller. It's like really, it's not tall enough at all. It needs to be a little wider than a. How wide is this? This is like about how thick and tall it should be. So that's 23 by 10. Let's do 24 by 12. No, 10 was good actually. So now I'm gonna walk around it and see if that collision box is a little better now. Feels a little better. Yeah, it could go a little taller actually. So I'm gonna do 14. Do you have somebody you can mess with like that? That sounds funny. Oh. Why is it not centered? Yeah, it's got 2 pixels here on the left, 1 pixel on the right, width of 24. I guess that's right. I guess it would need to be 1 more pixel wide to be perfectly centered. Okay, so I'm going to make this 1 more pixel wide. On the base. Or maybe 1 more pixel not as wide. Yeah, actually, I'm going to reduce its width slightly. This is 11. So yeah, that's odd. 13, that's odd. 19. Oh, I see. Okay, let's try that for a base. Save for web. Yeah, there we go. Now it's centered. Looks better for sure. Cool. I like this. It's a really interesting thing to find here in a room like this. Okay, so I'm going to take a quick little break, get a drink of water, because I'm thirsty. Yeah, Objective-C++ is a really simple thing, you guys. It's like, it's just basically you use Objective-C as you normally would, and then you can insert C++ anywhere you want. And it's really easy to turn your file into an Objective-C++ file. You just change it from a .m into a .mm. Or if you're in Xcode, you can just change the actual... If you open up your little info pane over here, you can actually change the type from C++ over to Objective-C++ source. So it's not like Objective-C++ is a different language at all. It's just a blend of Objective-C and C++. Essentially, it's just Objective-C with the ability to insert like a line of C++ wherever you want. Really, really simple thing. All right. okay, so yeah, I'll be right back. I forgot I made this tea earlier. Nice, lukewarm tea. Very cool. Lukewarm tea. Oh, interesting, R2. Wow. I didn't know OBS was written with... Oh, I guess that would make sense because it's cross-platform. They're going to probably mostly use C++ for their... for everything, and then Objective-C whenever. Unless they are they using a lot of Objective-C? Because that would be interesting to note. Because then they'd probably have to use an Objective-C compiler on Windows. Which I don't know what you, I guess you could use GNU. Hey, it does look like a heart. Yeah, with these two, or four. There's four different lights in this room. That's what's giving it that heart-like shape. Wow. If it were red tiles, it would be a perfect Valentine's Day gift. Oh, it's mostly C++. Okay, yeah, well then, but then basically what I would assume is happening is they're writing most of their code in C++. You already know R2. Okay, so the next step to this is to put some enemies back in this room and then make it so whenever an enemy is killed, it lights up another rune on this pillar, and once all the lights are on, then it lights up the lightning, and the lightning crackles and stuff. So this is going to be a special case. In fact, it's probably going to need a profile component now that I think about it, so that I can handle it in a special way, but it like uses its own custom graphics. So if I want to do a different switch in the future with totally different graphics but the same mechanics, then I can swap out the plist. So step one, open the box. Step two, put your dick in the box. Step three, give her the box. It's my dick in the box, baby. Okay. Starting with the profile. Similar to this computer zero profile thing. What? So we'll call this one switch one. Switch one. That'll do. Yeah, switch one. So, idle animation. This is as a single frame, so frame count one, doesn't matter that the delay is. Okay. So hit points. It's gonna need hit points. That's for sure. We need some HP. We'll do HP number. It's got five different runes, so we'll do five hit points. When it starts at five. No, I think it needs six hit points. So it starts at six. When it goes down to five, the first one's lit. Is that right? Let me think about that. It's six, five, four, three, two, one, zero. Yeah, it's just five hit points. Okay. So one and the when it the last rune lights up, that's when the animation happens. Yeah. If you're one of those people that loves writing game engines, yeah, man, just go ahead and write your own game engine. It is really fun. Definitely. I used to be more into making game engines when I was younger. I loved game engines back then, but now I'm just more about games. I'm like, I just rather focus on writing a cool game. So that's why I'm using Cocos 2DX. There's a lot that's done already. I mean, a ton. As you know, as you're starting to see yourself. So, hit points. What should I call these animations for, like, oh, I guess I could do. Yeah, oh, there's this. I already did this kind of thing before for the chest. There's this chest item, and it breaks up its hit animation into 3 frames, chest hit percent D into 3 frames, and then whenever it gets hit, it uses the next frame. So that's what I'll do for this one too. This will be called hit. Hit, and format is switch one. Rune. Oh man. Oh. Yeah, okay. I guess so this is gonna be different. I was just thinking that I exported all these graphics separately, but I'll make up for that here in a second. So switch one rune percent D frame count 5. Just gonna verify visually that these got exported correctly too. So switch items. Yeah, rune 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Cool. And lightning 0, 1, 2, 3. Hit. And we'll call this one active, where got this lightning. There's 4 frames there. And the delay between each frame is, we'll do 0.05. Pretty quick animation there. Doesn't need a release animation here. So it's idle hit active. Huh. Okay. This is a good start. Next, let's see how it's going. Constable. Yeah, nice. I like that you put cons before that because we're always awesome, right? Abort. Exit one. Right, so I'm giving this a profile component now. So profile component based on what's it called again? Switch one. And render component also you can just use switch one now, so it takes the first idle animation. So the first thing to verify is that this graphically still looks exactly the same. So that would verify that it's loading this property list and it's using it correctly. Cool. Oh, it died. It disappeared. So it changed. It turned on. Oh, it turned on the hit animation. So maybe I should actually export all the graphics for. Because this is using the same code as the existing item chest. I'm trying to think of how I'll do this. What's up, Dodge Whale? Welcome to the stream. So I'm trying to decide whether I should go back and export all these graphics with the runes embedded, or whether I should write some new code, which uses a separate sprite for the runes. Here's where it takes that hit animation. I think what I'm going to do actually is call it something else besides hit. And then if it's called like I don't know, decrement or whatever, it'll add like a it'll add another sprite, or it'll take the no. Yeah, that just changes how it all works. I'll have to recode stuff. All right, let's re-export all these animations with the runes. And I guess I'm all export with the lightning in there too. Man, that makes it so I can't use the flipping the lightning animation. Which way to go with this? Which way? There's benefits to both. You know what? Screw this. Whoops. No, I don't want to exit. Okay, so I've only got like 10 more minutes in today's stream anyways. I'm going to stop thinking about how to do this the right way. I'm just going to do it. So I'm going to go and add some lightning to this pillar right as it is. I don't even care that it's not supposed to be there yet. And we'll see how it looks. So I'm going to create a kit sprite. The first frame, switch one, lightning zero, true, position is going to be back to halfway through the size, that's going to be 24, so I'm just going to hack that in, 24, back to 0.5, 0.0. Parent is going to be, well, let's grab the parent, auto ref render equals entity create, no, entity create, entity get render component, entities.back. Hey, thanks for following, by the way. Render.sprite z1. Now let's run an animation on this. So auto ref anim equals kit anim, and this is a nice convenience function which just loads an animation. So this is switch one lightning percent D. Now let's run it. Sprite.run action. Repeat forever. Create. Animate. Create. Anim. Oh. Address of anim. Oh, it was a donation. Oh, thanks for donating. Thank you. Thanks so much for donating. Seriously. All profits from donations go towards bringing this game to Android, PlayStation 4, and Xbox. And if the guys from Retro VGS write me back, Retro VGS, which was freaking an awesome looking system. So if this works, then we'll have some lightning just bolting back and forth. Oh, cool. We do. But it breaks when it does that hit. So let's, I'm going to turn off that hit animation. We're just going to rename it something else for now so it doesn't run that. And then, okay, why did it do, I guess this should be zero. I guess that would make sense. Nope. This image was 48, wasn't it? Maybe it was only 32. Yeah, I think it was 32. Oh, width 37? What? Who made this 37 pixels wide? What's half of 37? 17.5? Is that right? That's not right. 18.5. Okay, so I'm just hacking this in so I can see what it looks like because the stream's almost over for today. And I wanted it to kind of at least get this switch looking cool. Nice. Now I got some lightning on there. Let's add the rune as well. So let's do one more sprite. Yeah, it's my job now. So I started off this Nano Games. This is a really good question. I started off this project, Songbringer, in November of this last year. So just like 4, 6, 7 months ago. And I put about 4 months into the game. And I was extremely broke at the time. Like, I have no money. I haven't been making money in years. Like, I made my last video game I made is called Hero Bash. It took like a year and a half to make. And it made no money, so I was just out. I'd already spent all my life savings making that game, and since it failed, I'm like, oh my god, what am I gonna do now? So I somehow was able to squeak by for the last, like, those first 4 months of making this game. I kept on making it full time, like I spent all my time making the game, and then I decided, you know, it was a little bit too early, but I decided to do the Kickstarter anyway. So I did a Kickstarter project. Thanks to everybody helping out here on the live stream. The Kickstarter project got better and better and better. And people donated money like every day. The Kickstarter went amazing and got more than its goal. So the Kickstarter was able to raise enough funds to actually continue making this game full time. So essentially, yes, this is now technically my job. I do this full time. I make this is great. I'm doing my favorite thing in the world full time. It's awesome. But no, there's no company paying me to do this. This is all thanks to crowdfunding. This is thanks to the awesomeness of cool people on the internet. What's up, Mike? So I'm going to put rune zero up here as well. So we can see the first one. There, it'll have one rune. All right, cool. So that's kind of what it's going to look like. Basically, what's going to happen here is you fight all the enemies on the screen, and as you fight like one, as you fight more enemies, like you kill one enemy, and this lights up with one thing. The next enemy you kill lights up another, and then another, and then another. Once you've killed every enemy on the screen, this lightning bolt appears right here, and all of these runes and everything will be colored according to the door. So, let me show you the door. So once that, oh, there's no enemies at all in this world because I turned them all off. But once you've enabled that switch, that enables this door to open up. So that's what this is all about. So since this door here is red, those, that lightning and those runes in the other room over here are going to be red colored as well. And there's other switch colors. There's like purple switches, red switches and stuff like that. So that's what'll be the visual clue as a player that this switch is connected to that big door. Oh, thanks, Nano Games. You don't have to do that though. It's not, you know, I don't mean for anyone to feel like you have to donate at all or you have to pre-order the game or whatever. This is just This is my gift to everyone is doing these live streams. So yeah, that's it. There's no strings attached. Yep. So, okay, that's it for today's stream. I spent about 2 hours here just basically drawing this switch thing and animating it. And now the next step's what I'm going to do after tonight's stream, after I get some dinner and stuff like that. I'm going to come back to this and make this all work how I was imagining. So, like I just said, it'll light up each rune, and then that lightning will appear, and it'll enable that door to open up and all that. And then, yeah, by tomorrow I'll have a much cooler switch than it used to be. So that's it for today's stream. Thanks again for watching, you guys. I really appreciate it. And I'll be back streaming again tomorrow. Same time. Same wizard time. So once again, thank you, everyone.